March 21st, 2014.
Good morning, we're going to start our meeting, convene, there you go, that's a good word. I'm the Board of Public Works, and we're here today to discuss the budget for fiscal year 2015, I believe. So, I guess the meeting is called to order.
All right.
Ed?
Get things started here. Just so the board knows, the city council last night passed the stormwater utility. So that's been incorporated, and we have a handout for that package also, which we'll walk you through. I'm going to turn over the start of this to Anne Marie Levy, our financial administrator, who actually crafted the budget with the input from the divisions and staff. Anne Marie?
So the first section in your package is for the general fund. The first page on your package shows the summary of the general fund. The requested expenditures for fiscal year 2015 are $2,607,340. That's a $681,756 difference, reduction from the previous year. And what we did in this budget, which is a little bit different from previous years, we decided to reallocate all of the personnel who typically get reallocated through the indirect cost schedule. So we took a look at what percentage of people's time we think should be allocated to each of the enterprise funds. And then rather than doing that through the indirect cost schedule, we did it through personal services and the general fund. We also took out the storm drain and flood control divisions because they now are going into an enterprise fund. So that's largely the reason for the increase that you see. The summary on the first page shows you all of the, actually the net reduction in personal services, again, largely due to those reallocations of personnel. And the summary page summarizes all of the divisions, engineering, storm drains, administration. All of those changes are indicated on the first page. We have a $47,755 increase net in the general fund operations and maintenance expense. The increase is driven largely by the recreation division increase. And when we get to that division, you can see exactly what each of those components are.
That recreation increase is for Florence Fields and the maintenance required of that.
And again, is a capital increase, mainly driven by the recreation division. So the changes, the next sheet that we have is engineering. There's a reduction in personal services driven by the reallocation of each individual's personal services expense to the various enterprise funds where they spend the majority of their time. So you can see there's the details for city engineer, senior civil engineer, assistant civil engineer. All of those are, the allocation portion is laid out in the narrative that describes the change. And then there's an increase because of computer system expenses. Net decrease is $323,294. Administration purchasing also has a decrease. We reallocated again personal services and an anticipated increase in electricity expense drives that O&M increase. General Highway Division has an increase in personal services, and that we have an SMEO that's currently working in sewer that the General Highway Division believes that position should be reallocated over to the General Highway Division.
What does that stand for?
Special Motor Equipment Operator.
Okay, thank you.
The increases in operations and maintenance, those were submitted by the General Highway Superintendent. He took a look at his historical activity and his anticipated increases. and came up with a $40,430 overall increase in O&M.
We were instructed to create a level services budget. That's why you're seeing some of these as increases, because of, we're providing level services rather than dollar value, just so you know that.
Snow and ice is level funded. And then here in the sanitary storm drain division, there's the reallocation of personnel, 33% to the stormwater enterprise fund and 66% to sewer enterprise fund. So that 66% had been previously allocated through the indirect cost schedule, and right now it's just going through our personal services detail.
So you must have this huge matrix of every staff person and their allocation by fund?
Yes. So I have a personal services, actually it's a series of spreadsheets that I'm required to submit to the finance director's office for each budget cycle. It details each individual, their annual increase given their contractual agreements for each fiscal year, their longevity, their uniform allowance, all of the personal services types of expenses that go along with each individual. And then this year, they were allocated on a percentage basis. So they appear not only in general highway division, but they're also in, if necessary, if it's applicable, they're in the water, sewer, and storm drain enterprise funds.
We're pleased with the change overall, because I think if you drill down and you look at these spreadsheets that Anne Marie has, you can pick anyone in the department, understand what they do, and then look at how their time is allocated among the different funding sources. So to me, it's like a lot more traceable or understandable, whereas before it was through the indirects, it was a little, you know, it was not as clear to understand what people in the department were doing and how their positions were being funded. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of different changes you see in the work that Anne Marie has done, but we think it's great. It's a great process.
No, I applaud that, because I do think it makes, you know, that indirect is sort of something that people get all tangled up about in Northampton, and if we can tie it back to more specificity, that they can trace their spreadsheets themselves, mm-hmm. then I think it really reveals a lot more transparency about a budget process.
And I understand this is the first year that you've done it, but have they been keeping track before this year?
Keeping track?
Of their allocation across columns.
Well, I think that it was done on the basis of where, for instance, Ann Fersenetti, who works in the front office, she was 100% general fund.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't accurately depict the work that she does.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
She processes payroll for every mm-hmm. division, so obviously a portion of her time is spent on water, sewer, initially, or eventually it'll be storm drain as well. And then she processes trench permits, and water entries, sewer entries. So we decided that it's not fair to allocate her 100% to the general fund. So we reallocated a portion of her time, given her activities, to the enterprise funds. And then Terry Yushko was 50%, because she filled a vacant position in the past. She was allocated strictly to the enterprise funds, but she spends a lot of time on the general highway division. So whereas 50% of Ann's time was taken away from the general fund, 50% of Terry Yushko's time was allocated back to the general fund. The net difference is 100% principal clerk, but it more accurately reflects the time that they spend in each of the enterprise funds for those activities.
I guess my question was more minuscule than that. Like, do they keep track on a weekly basis or a monthly basis of how much time they put on each of the columns, or was it just an overall guess on your part?
I think it was a thoughtful consideration.
Yeah, right.
Yes.
Well,
we discussed it in the supervisors meeting,
right,
that we develop a mechanism,
right,
for actually tracking time.
Mm-hmm.
Jim had a point that could vary year to year.
Yeah.
That was my
yeah.
next question,
yeah.
exactly. Yeah.
So we're trying to be as fair as we can,
mm-hmm.
given the activities that go
mm-hmm.
on, but there will be fluctuation
mm-hmm.
depending on what's happening in the department.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's not like we have billable time to each enterprise fund.
Yeah, and that's,
I thought that's where you were going.
Well,
so,
it's just
yeah.
my
yeah.
40-year history, so. I vote nobody else in your mouth does it, but.
So the same thing is going on with the flood control station. We've reallocated that to the enterprise fund. That results in a $45,625 increase in that division. Cemetery division, the increase in personal services is due mainly to the main union negotiated contract increases. And then we have a new uniform service that we anticipate increases in that line item as well. So there's an O&M increase of $3,000. The recreation division has increases overall in personal services, operations and maintenance, and capital increase. And there's an additional SMEO position because of the anticipated additional job responsibilities.
That's to take care of Florence Fields. We have a full-time person dedicated to that.
Full-time person?
Well, it's who'll be shared amongst other things with recreation, but once those fields comes into service in another year and a half, it'll be pretty much full-time there.
So there's also relatively significant increases in fertilizer and grass seed, that type of thing. Again, Florence Field, it's not anticipated that that would be recurring, but the initial investment is reflected in this year's budget.
The mayor has approved an organic budget for Florence Field, just so the board knows that. So the first year there's a large increase in that that will historically go down over time, prepping the fields to go to organic.
My understanding, you know, maintaining a field is sort of perpetual renovation. It's seems like it's a standard that you just you constantly have to be.
You're aerating, you're overseeding. Or
exactly. You don't just mow it and put down fertilizer. You really, you're constantly adding new seed to it. I think particularly playing field, you have to do aeration, vibratory aeration ideally, to loosen the turf. It gets compacted. Grass doesn't like to grow in dense stuff. So it makes sense to me. I mean, it might go down over time, but I think it might not. That would be my guess. But you really want to keep the fields in good shape. You'd have to be constantly working on it.
The next pages in your budget provide the line item detail, so you can go through and examine each of the categories for expense. For all of these kind of feed into the summaries that we just went through. This is the operations and maintenance and capital portions of the budget.
Hey, Marie, in the reallocation of all this staff, if we look at water and sewer, was there a net change to the allocation to those?
Yes. So you'll see, again, an increase in personal services due to the reallocation on the spreadsheets themselves. But I'm anticipating, because I looked at the indirect apportionment of personal services from the engineering division, the admin division, storm drain divisions through the indirects, there should be a fairly significant decrease in our indirects this year because the reallocations occurred through the general fund rather than through the indirect schedules. So we don't have the indirects yet. We're still waiting on those. I didn't program any changes, so when you're looking at these budgets, there are going to be, these aren't the finals. We still need indirect costs. I think we're waiting on the dewatering for the, storm drain?
The catch basin cleaning management, which would be in the stormwater enterprise fund.
So there's still some numbers that need to be plugged in. I'm still waiting to confirm the debt service numbers. I do that every year through the treasurer's office. That hasn't been accomplished yet, so there might be some minor changes, but for the most part, we're kind of honing in on where we're going to be with the enterprise funds.
So if I look at on the very first page of the general fund, and the difference from prior year is $681,000. A good deal of that goes to the stormwater utility, I assume. But there are other pieces that might end up in water and sewer enterprise.
Right, yep. So when we look at our summary pages for the water and sewer enterprise fund, you're going to see all the increases that have occurred as a result of those reallocations.
Okay.
And hopefully there's 100% for every individual through the reallocation and the general fund portion.
I heard if there isn't. I saw a two-thirds employee one day. He didn't look good.
So do we have any more questions on the general fund? Or?
That's a good question. I'm wondering if you want to, are you going to just go through the whole thing? This is an initial, we're not voting on this today.
No.
It's really just a discovery and ask questions.
Mm-hmm. And you can take the spreadsheets home and take a look at the details, and if you have any additional questions.
What's our budget process time for?
Our budget process is hopefully once tonight. We can have, if we get the indirects, we might have some of the votes done. The mayor needs to have a budget to the city council 45 days in advance of the fiscal year. So basically mid-May, he needs to have that done. So probably the first meeting in April, we need to wind everything up at the latest.
So in your package, the next section is the sewer enterprise fund rate schedule. So basically, the way that the schedules are presented, we're going kind of from an overview down into the nitty-gritty detail of each line item. And the overview for the sewer enterprise fund, again, you can see the indirect and directs have not been changed for fiscal year 2015. That should be where we see some change in the schedule. But currently, I programmed in, you met previously to discuss the capital program. I programmed in those changes. Again, the changes to personal services. And at this point in time, we're looking at a 2.89% increase in our sewer rate as a result of all of those changes.
So the new rate is the actual rate or the recommended fee, or what is the difference?
There's this, for fiscal year 2015, the actual and the recommended are the same.
Yes, I see that. Is there, so that would be the rate, and we would have to vote on that to set that rate?
So this is, again, it's going to change. Obviously, the indirects are going to impact the schedule.
Okay.
But that's about where we're ending up right now. You can kind of take a look at that, see if you're comfortable with that, whether you want to make any changes, whether you want to think about reallocating. One of the things
I'm just trying to understand what that is. It's just, it's the best estimate for now.
For now,
yeah.
Yep.
So the recommended fee is the calculated fee?
Yes.
And then the actual is what we vote?
Yes. And basically the recommended fee is what's required to cover your expenses. As in the past, we've kind of manipulated those numbers in anticipation of some large projects. We don't want to see too much of an increase in the future. So in this schedule, when you're looking at 2017, you see a 7.21% increase. That's because of the, we programmed in the debt service costs for the DPW facility. So going forward, we might want to consider how we approach that anticipated increase.
Right, on the next page is the assumption pages that went into this budget. You'll see that in each enterprise fund.
Yeah.
So you see where those blocks of money came from, as we discussed at the last meeting we had on the budget, and what projects you wanted to move forward.
So, in all likelihood, the direct and indirects will go down, so the rate increase will be less than 2.89%. Is that what we'd expect?
That's what we would expect.
Okay.
But then again, because of that anticipated increase in 2017, if the rate goes down too much,
mm-hmm.
It's going to have a significant increase in that one.
Right.
Anyway.
And we dialed back rate increases because we wanted to make room for people not to feel hit too hard with the stormwater.
Mm-hmm. That's correct. But we also wanted to make sure that we're showing that we are prepared to build a new facility. At least the enterprise funds are willing to, indebtedness for their share of it. We just need to wait for the general fund to come up with their 50% funding.
Is that the real date?
No, that's not. It's a date that shows a projected increase that if it was to take off, this is the rate change.
Is there a date?
There's not a date.
There's not a date.
So that's something that...
I wish there was a date.
If that could be pinned down, that would be helpful for the schedules as well. If fiscal year 2017 isn't realistic, then, you know, we don't have to worry so much about our impact on the rates, or we can plan a little bit better for that increase. So getting a realistic date for the requirement for that debt service would be helpful for planning purposes.
Isn't that date based on when the city is retiring other debt?
That's the current conversation, but the mayor has not committed to the project at this point.
Right. But there is some debt that's being retired.
In 2019, there's a good part of debt falls off for Northampton High School, and another project that I don't recall what it is, mm-hmm. Frees up quite a bit of debt service. The question is, can the city still undertake a large project with that debt service gone, or are they going to have to face a debt exclusion override at that point to help fund it?
I guess I would be concerned about the rates, knowing what's in my draft comprehensive wastewater management plan.
That's what I was going to say.
You're going to be shocked when you start putting some real projects in there that involve improving things at the plant.
Yeah. I don't think we're going to be shocked.
You won't
be. In the public will be shocked.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So one of the other things that we've done in fiscal year 2015, you've decided to utilize some of the free cash or retained earnings for funding capital projects. So I put that into the schedule under the reserve for capital projects line item. And you can see there's a fund balance funding source for $700,000. That money, if it's voted on to be funded through the capital projects, would become available around January of 2015 after DOR certifies our free cash. So those projects would not be able to until the cash is
right. Those two projects were the Thickner building upgrades and the VFD bypass.
VFDs.
Variable frequency drive, which is our inflow pumps.
We don't have an actual line item in our budget under capital projects for those two projects. They're listed in the budget as a capital transfer from the fund balance that would have to be voted on by City Council after DOR certifies our free cash balance.
Should we put money someplace else in the budget to get those projects started so we don't have to wait till February of next year?
What are you thinking?
Well, like engineering, you know,
yeah.
Or preparing plans and specs,
right,
or whatever,
yeah, right.
Whatever needs to be done. It seems like we're going to lose a whole year just waiting for the $700,000 to become available, and we have it right now. Right? We have the money right now.
The other thing that you could consider doing is having the City Council approve the transfer. They've already certified free cash for the end of fiscal year 2013. So you could ask for that transfer in this fiscal year in anticipation. Mm-hmm. Ned and I, when we initially discussed the projects, he didn't seem to think that they would start until after January. But if that's not the case, then we should be anticipating the expenses.
Right, we need to go through the designer selection board process for that. That'll take up quite a bit of time. By the time we actually hire an engineer, get someone on board, it's probably going to be around that time frame where we're going to start looking at the project. And construction definitely won't happen in this calendar year for these projects. It's definitely going to be next year at the earliest.
But Mike, you were thinking, were you thinking, that this way we would overcome the, any political hump earlier on and not have to wait until the cash is available to make sure that we can start on the project. And so, were you thinking that?
Well, I was only part of it. I was worried that we couldn't do anything until the transfer was made, and I thought that was going to slow us up. Ned's explanation says that perhaps designer selection, which I guess doesn't cost us anything.
No, it's just a process we have to go through.
Might. I mean, I would hate to think it would take 6 months. So I'm still wondering if we could use some money to get started before the transfer occurs.
Can I just finish my thought? So what I'm wondering is if it would be helpful to have a letter of support or a letter where we, from the city to, that says this is our intention as soon as this happens so that we don't have to wait on any political process and we can start that, the process of selecting. I mean, would, if that's your concern, would it be helpful to have some go-ahead from the city?
A go-ahead from the city or a go-ahead from the board that you want to do this trip?
I'm asking, which is appropriate.
So well, we control the $700,000, it's just waiting for the free cash to get started.
Right, which would be sometime in January, it would come
okay,
up.
So it's
DLR.
In our hands.
So it's not, we don't need to go ahead from the city.
If there's free cash that's available, and we have the time to go through designer selection, we could go through designer selection to the point where we wanted to hire somebody, and if we didn't have the money, we could request a transfer from the city council now in order to fund the project to keep it moving, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's what we would do. If we could advance the project now, we would move ahead, and if we reached the point where we wanted to sign a contract and we need money to do it, then we could plug into the city council and ask for the transfer, and then the money would be available.
So you'd have to do that during this time frame. So basically the complication is that you're funding through free cash rather than putting the item into your capital budget. But when I'm looking at what we had last year, you included $340,000 for a control building, $65,000 for plant-wide intercom. We had $160,000 for wastewater treatment plant communications. So those projects are still, they haven't been addressed. So we've got a lot of things that we're still anticipating doing on the capital side.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly, if you want to have City Council approve the transfer now, then that, you know, you can go ahead and recommend that. But it seems as though the time frame within, you know, next spring doesn't look as though it's unrealistic,
right,
just given everything that needs to be done.
We're still trying to get the projects off the ground that we approved.
Yeah, got it.
And I'd rather not put something else in front of the council while we have bigger things to deal with. Right. Okay. Thank you.
So you can see on the assumptions page, I've kind of summarized a lot of the capital projects that we've been talking about. The DPW facility is in the rate schedule, but it's only in debt service. And again, that was anticipated to begin in FY17. You might want to rethink that if it's not realistic. There's a sewer line replacement that was approved last year, $1 million. That money is still available. I don't know the timing. Was that the industrial park? Yeah.
That is.
So that's another project that needs to be.
That should be in construction this summer.
And then we have, again, the control building, plant-wide intercom, wastewater treatment plant communications. This year funded through fund balance transfers, the $550,000 for the thickener building and the $150,000 for the BFD bypass.
Presented the budget, and the board said it looked good.
I guess I'll have to get the tape for that. So on the next set of schedules is the sewer enterprise summary, and here again you can see where those allocations are coming into your personal services. So the difference in personal services overall for the sewer enterprise is an increase, a net increase of $348,337, and largely driven by all of those reallocations. So there are some changes. One of the principal account So we had allocated 50% of an account clerk's position for fiscal year 2014 into the sewer division to get started on some of the work that needs to be done for the storm in anticipation of storm drain work. And this year, because of personnel changes in the transfer station budget, we've created a solid waste coordinator position, and that principal clerk will be 100% funded through the transfer station. So that resulted in a decrease in the sewer division, the sanitary drain division of the sewer enterprise fund.
Can you clarify that? I mean, you're saying that we will have 100% solid waste coordinator?
Yes. But she's currently, this year, Karen Bequillion, we lost that position last year, and Deb Leiser has been filling that in terms of the gatekeeper's schedule. Some of the job duties that were being performed by Karen and I are being performed by Deb Leiser. So she's going to be put into the solid waste coordinator position, 100%. We had anticipated that she would be spending a portion of her time in the sewer division, the sanitary storm drain portion of the sewer division. But realistically, because of the personnel changes, she's been 100% transfer station. We're going to recognize that in 2015, and she's going to be funded 100% through the transfer station.
This is not related to the planner position in Susan Waite, which is what you might be thinking.
No, I'm just trying to understand. Yeah, I figured out it must be separate. But she's spending her time doing it, so we're acknowledging it. But that's just called solid waste coordinator.
Yes.
Okay.
Karen was the senior solid waste coordinator position, so this is a newly created position under the transfer station enterprise fund.
You mentioned getting some input from the mayor on the deficit for the solid waste deficit. Has that transpired?
I met with the mayor on Tuesday, and he did not want to commit any general funds to the transfer station. So we need to figure out our budget gap, what we're going to do for FY15 that we have currently in that enterprise fund.
And that's in our pile today. I mean, the as it is currently before we talk about it. So we can be thoughtful about it.
Courageous conversation.
Well, that's the thought that comes to my mind, is we might ultimately decide to terminate the operation of the transfer station in FY15, in which case this position wouldn't be funded.
And did you float that idea at all to the mayor, just to get his response?
Yeah, I actually provided him with the alternate budget that Dave Letta had created, looking at the hazardous waste collection event, be funded by the general fund, because anyone in the community can come to it. Some of the shared responsibilities of some staff members, such as the recycling coordinator. She works on community-wide events, not events for the transfer station. But like I said, it came back as no.
But my point is that did you float the idea that we might totally reduce, that we might do away with the transfer station?
The mayor's aware of that.
Okay, so, and he didn't balk.
He had actually talked about setting up another task advisory force, a task force or something to look at solid waste needs in the city, what we might be doing going forward.
Right.
But he felt that we should run the transfer station for one more year before that final decision is made.
So what I'm wondering, I'm sorry to hijack this a little bit. Should I email BJ to add solid waste transfer station to the meeting on Tuesday, and we should talk about maybe setting up our own little subcommittee for that?
I think that might be premature. I said the mayor seemed to want to take on a bigger picture view with the citizens of Northampton on this as a some kind of committee of some sort.
I hear you on that one, but we have to, the department has to decide in terms of budget what where we're going on that, and I don't know.
So there's money in the Solid Waste Enterprise Fund. There's enough money in the Enterprise Fund to fund the operation of the transfer station next year fairly comfortably. Ultimately, the operation transfer station will run in the red, but the infusion of money needed to keep it open will come from the balance in the Enterprise Fund. So in the long run, not sustainable. In the short run, very doable.
Okay.
But obviously, figuring out what's sustainable would be important.
So what you're saying is it's running a deficit, but it's not, it's projected to run a deficit, but it's not broke.
That's
so
correct.
If you look at the last package that you
well,
have.
It's still spending money.
Right, right, but as far as closing the gates on
sure.
Saturday.
So at the last budget right. meeting we had, I believe I said there was about $1.9 million in free cash that was certified in the Solid Waste Enterprise
mm-hmm.
Fund. That money is available. However, we were working on the financial assurance mechanism for the 30-year post-closure landfill,
mm-hmm.
and that some of that money was going to disappear into the financial assurance mechanism to make sure we have our long-term obligations taken care of.
Mm-hmm.
Like, decommissioning the landfill flare in another 10 years,
right.
things like that, some big costs that we didn't program initially.
Mm.
Right. Okay. All right, thank you.
So the Landfill Enterprise Fund is the last package that's in your entire presentation. It's
mm-hmm.
It kind of looks, it's more vertical, but that's it, yep. So the projected deficit is
$120,000. I'm just trying to figure out which pile.
The big pile.
Got it.
We have $208,945 in personal services, and that includes the position of the solid waste coordinator and then the solid waste planner positions. So if you want to start looking at how to make this sustainable, knowing that you have that planned deficit, something like, you know, the elimination of positions that if you're feeling as though the solid waste planner is more of a general fund job responsibility than it is related to the transfer station, then we can start eliminating some of the expenses that we don't think can be sustained through the transfer station.
Okay, thank you.
Great. I don't know if you want to go straight to the enterprise fund.
You want to finish the sewer first?
Yeah, I apologize.
So again, looking at our summary for the Sewer Enterprise Fund, we see that personal services increase driven largely by the reallocation of personnel services. There's a $91,500 increase in O&M expenses, largely driven by a $60,000 increase in rentals and leases because of the generator. That's anticipated being leased in fiscal year 2015.
Right. Hopefully, at the last meeting, the board recommended
that
we purchase that, which we're going to do, but it's going to take a while to put together the RFP to do it and secure it and procure it. So in the interim, we still have a rental agreement that we need to have somewhere in the budget, whether it takes 3 months or 6 months to finalize.
Does this amount of money cover the whole year?
Yes.
So in your capital net decrease, there's a decrease of $746,271. The temporary emergency generator expense, the eventual purchase of that generator is included as a capital item increase, but you have decreases because of the sewer line replacement for Industrial Drive was included in FY 2014. It goes away in 2015, as does the wastewater treatment plant communication upgrades and the control building and the plant-wide intercom and alarm system. We have an anticipated decrease in principal payments and interest payments on our long-term debt, and then the capital increases that are going to be funded by the fund balance are the thickener building and the BFD bypass. So the Sewer Enterprise Fund is made up of the sanitary storm drain division and a treatment plant, wastewater treatment plant division. And under the sanitary storm drains, this is where that reallocation of our storm drain personnel that normally was recorded in the general fund is now reallocated 66% to sanitary storm drains and 33% or sanitary drains and then 33% to the storm drains.
Just so you know, that's been the historic split that we have used in the past in that division.
And that shows up in the indirect cost schedule or have shown. It should go away this year. The largest decrease, again, in the sanitary division is that reduction of the sewer line replacement. That's the biggest driver for your capital net decrease.
Can you explain why that shows up as a reduction?
Typically, you fund your sewer line replacement at $400,000 every year in anticipation of large projects.
Mm-hmm.
Last year, we decided to increase that line item by $1 million for the industrial drive. So this year, for 2015, it'll be funded at $400,000, not $1,400,000.
Because last year we did $1.4 million.
Right. So this division also includes a $282,500 increase for vehicle purchases. And those vehicles are a six-wheel dump truck. There's an allocation of two engineering vehicles, and then when we put together the Stormwater Enterprise Fund, we tried to look at a reasonable evaluation of what vehicles would be replaced going forward, and then we tried to develop a mechanism for funding the replacement of those vehicles. As a result of that, there's an allocation of that funding mechanism to the sanitary division. There's also an allocation to the storm drain division.
Right, and those vehicles. Those vehicles are up behind you on the board. And so we went through that when we were creating the stormwater utility budget. We just haven't erased the board yet.
So I still don't have this one in my mind. So of the 282,000, one is part of that money is to purchase a six-wheel dump truck for the sewer division.
That's correct, which is about $180,000.
Okay. And then the next piece, the two engineering allocation, could you explain that again, please?
Sure, those are two, they're called Ford Transits. They're small type vans, and it's a sewer, water, and general fund share of a third. So it's $20,000 in the sewer enterprise fund to assist in the purchase of these two vehicles.
So purchase two new vehicles to be shared by engineering, stormwater, and sewer.
That's correct. Yes, for the engineering vehicles for our staff.
Great.
This is all in the mayor's capital plan that he's taking to city council, these equipment purchases.
But if they come out of the, some of it comes out of the general fund.
That's correct.
Then that's why it's in his capital plan.
That's correct.
That piece is in his capital.
Right. We've asked for the general fund to pick up a third for the work that they do on city roadways. Another general fund work.
So these vehicles are like $30,000 a piece?
Approximately.
Is that what we're paying?
Yep.
Okay. So then there's some more money in here.
Mm-hmm. Which is the stormwater sewer allocations of vehicles and scheduled replacements.
Next, 107.5.
And how many vehicles is that? That's still new vehicle purchase, though, right?
It's a, let me see if I can pull it right there. So we had a one-ton, it was vehicle number 804. In fiscal year 2015, $15,840 is allocated. That vehicle is, the total cost is $72,000, but we're only allocating a portion in 2015 in anticipation of a future purchase of that vehicle. The Vactor truck, number 310, also needs to be replaced. That's a $300,000 vehicle. Replacement year is 2025. So $18,000 was programmed into the schedule for that purchase. The camera van needs to be replaced in 2016. That's a $175,000 vehicle. So that results in $57,750 programmed into this year's replacement vehicle schedule. And then we have vehicle number 904, which is a one-ton, $72,000 vehicle, replacement year 2017. So $15,840 was programmed into this schedule for replacement. So we have a 107.
So we're not proposing to purchase these vehicles. We're setting aside money to purchase them.
Encumbering them year to year and get that. That's right.
And as I recall, that was in the mayor's capital plan. The
5-year
plan that he presented to the.
Mm-hmm. In the engineering vans, is that allocation for future purchase, or do we propose
that's
to do that?
Year.
That's in
that's this year.
In FY 15.
Same with the 6-wheel dump truck.
Gotcha.
The Ford Transit.
Yes.
So the treatment plant pumping station, the overall net decrease for that division is $358,321. There's an increase in personal services, again as a result of the personal services allocation. $54,500 increase in operations and maintenance expense. Again, driven by that generator release. And there's a $445,000 decrease in capital. And those are the projects that we included in 2014 budget to be funded. They're now in our capital line item. And they're not recurring in 2015. The 2015 projects are going to be funded through the fund balance transfer, and that shows up as a capital transfer on that sheet. So we're anticipating a decrease in principal payments on long-term debt and interest on long-term debt. We don't have the direct and indirect expenses yet. I put those in at that level funded. Although our anticipation is that that number will decrease.
Where are you looking? Oh.
The indirect and direct expenses.
Okay. So there are two sheets for indebtedness.
Yes. And on your reserve account, that's where we're recognizing the increase for the fund balance transfer. The next three pages are the line item detail. If you want to go through and look at each of the different expense categories for the sanitary and wastewater treatment plant divisions of the Sewer Enterprise Fund. And then your next set of schedules is for the Water Enterprise Fund rate schedule.
So what do you do in your spare time?
Unbelievable. Huge undertaking.
It is.
So there we have a projected increase of 4.31% for the budget for fiscal year 2015.
I'm sure you're going to get to it, but why does the undesignated fund balance drop? What's the $2.5 million drop?
I believe that you determined that you were going to fund some projects through free cash this year, so those are programmed in as fund balance transfers.
You have the Roberts Meadow dam removal, and then the money that may be a reimbursable from FEMA.
Oh, yeah.
And then you have the Roberts Meadow Brook slope stabilization project that will need a source of $500,000 to draw from, although we do have a FEMA obligation for 75% of that, so we'll still have to fund it. Most of the money will come back on that project.
So those details are listed on your assumptions page, and a notation of the FEMA reimbursement is also noted there. So the water enterprise summary pages are after those two schedules. Our difference from the prior year is a $2,726,559 increase. Personal services, same situation. We included our reallocations in that line item. So the operations and maintenance increase, largely driven by a $150,000 increase in architecture and engineering expense.
Against what projects?
That would be a mad question.
Sorry, you.
The increase in architecture and engineering, what are we spending that money at? $150,000?
Just general, any design work we might do in the water department. We have an ongoing project with the Pine Street Bridge. That's been programmed, but any other design work that might come up through our engineers, Tate and Howard.
Okay.
Replacement of some valving at the water treatment plant would be part of it also. There's some pumps with some butterfly valves up there. We replaced a couple, but I believe there's a schedule to replace three more valves at this point.
Mm-hmm.
Is that number flexible? I'm not sure we want to undertake a 4% increase in rate. And I know that the indirects, when we have those real numbers, will reduce the increase. But I was just wondering if there's another way we might be able to reduce the rate increase.
So that line item is typically funded at $50,000 for the distribution portion of the Water Enterprise Fund. That was increased to $150,000. In fiscal year 2015. And then under the treatment plant portion, we didn't have a funded, we had encumbered funds for that line item in 2014. So that was funded at $50,000 for 2015. So I don't know if there's some way to get to a better estimate of what those architecture and engineering expenses might be.
It may be okay. It may be okay.
Capital increases. We have $190,000 in vehicle replacement, $118,000 in equipment replacement expense. That's the lift system and metal fabrication and a wastewater treatment plant valve. We have a $600,000 increase in waterline replacement, $20,000 increase in water improvements, $25,000 increase watershed management. That line item total is $125,000. And part of that is due to the Roberts Meadow Brook slope stabilization project. And then the largest impact is $1 million for the Upper Roberts Meadow Reservoir Dam removal, but there's a possible 75% FEMA reimbursement of that. And then there's $440,000 for the Roberts Meadow Brook slope stabilization. That project total is $500,000 with the FEMA 75% reimbursement. So that's your summary of the Water Enterprise Fund.
Before we leave that page, it looks like we have two entries that relate to the Roberts Meadow Brook slope stabilization. We've got this kitty now of $125,000, which looks like the local share once we receive the reimbursement. And then down the last line is $440,000.
Maybe double counting.
I'm wondering if we've got things in there twice. Yeah.
So my notes indicate that the Roberts Meadow Dam reconstruction, we have been encumbering funds under a capital line item for the engineering costs of that project. And then the construction portion was to be funded through a capital line item.
That's the dam. It's confusing because we have two projects with the same name. One's dam and one's slope stabilization.
It looks like it might be double counting. Because the project was estimated, it was $441,000 or $442,000, I think, if I remember right. And then we'd have a reimbursement of approximately all but $125,000, which is what the board approved moving forward to make the project work. For our application, we have to commit our 25% to FEMA.
But is the note wrong, or is $125,000 necessary for watershed management?
Well, last year's budget was $100,000 for watershed management, if I remember right, in FY14.
Mm-hmm. And that was increased to $125,000. And the explanation was for FEMA grant, Roberts Meadow slope stabilization. But then there was also the notes from the capital meeting where it was decided that that would be funded through the fund balance transfer. So if that either one of those line items can be reduced, then I can take them out.
We haven't expended anything on the FY14 on watershed management, $100,000. So if we kept that and encumbered it, then this $125,000 would disappear this fiscal year because we counted it down to $440,000 down below.
Well, the $25,000 would disappear and they've encumbered $100,000. Just did. Thank you.
So
it might be double counted?
Yes.
Hey. Sorry about that.
No. Good, Mike.
So we're going to delete any addition to watershed management and just encumber those funds from 2014.
Yeah.
Last night that the board watched all the financial aspects of department operations. Apparently that was true.
All might be a stretch.
So just to sum it, so what we're talking about is reducing or eliminating the $25,000 increase?
Actually $125,000. That line item was funded at $125,000.
Oh.
And it sounds as though we're just going to encumber the remaining funds from fiscal year 2014 and have no funding for that line item in 2015. So the overall impact is a decrease of $125,000.
I move we institute a finder's fee for such
second.
I'm thinking, where can we use that money now?
Right.
reduce the increase.
No, I know.
Yeah,
you were working on it.
It's just not. It's just not enough money.
Okay, so now it's going to be 4.01%.
Get lower somehow.
So the Water Enterprise Fund is made up of two sections, the general fund portion, which is the distribution, and then the treatment plant division. And those same changes are indicated in those two divisions that are supporting backup. We have a slight increase in municipal principal payments on our outstanding debt. And that's due to, we have two payments that we have to make on a DPW facility borrowing for the architecture and engineering study that was done.
Where are you?
I'm under municipal indebtedness. So the distribution and the treatment plant, we kind of went over the summary, which shows all of the changes. If you want to look at the individual changes to distribution and then to the treatment plant, you can go through each of those line items. The next impact would be an increase in municipal indebtedness payments. And also interest. There's a decrease in interest payments on outstanding debt.
On the general fund variance explanations, under the capital increases, I see that same $125,000 for the Roberts Meadow slope stabilization.
Yeah, so that's where in the budget that line item would appear.
Okay.
So it's in both the summary and it's in
the budget. Oh, shoot. Yeah, all right, my bad. Okay, gotcha. Sorry. Okay.
So direct and indirects were, again, put in, just plugged in as a no-change line item. It would be anticipated because of the allocation of personal services that should decrease. And then the determination was made to fund through the fund balance the Upper Roberts Meadow Reservoir Dam removal and the Roberts Meadow Brook Slope Stabilization Project. And this is where that $500,000 line item should be.
This $100,000 figure for the valve replacement in the water, is this ordinary maintenance, or
we hope not?
Is it were they defective to begin with, or have defects showed up?
Well, one of the valves failed, and we don't know if the others will fail. And when they fail, they cause damage. So we're trying to be a little proactive in removing this type of valve that's been problematic. Is our reasoning. And once these valves are replaced, we're hoping that I'll never touch the valves in my professional career here.
What kind of valves are going in place of the butterfly valves?
We're not quite sure yet. There's one with an external spring that is sort of an internal check valve now. And they're looking at one with an external spring. They're also looking at the possibility of a Tideflex style valve, believe it or not, which in this case, we don't have a lot of room between the wall of the clarifier and where this valve can fit. And they're looking at whether this Tideflex style valve, whether it could extend beyond the wall of the clarifier and function suitably in that arrangement. But those are two that they're looking at right now.
How big is the pipe?
think it's, I want to say it's a 12-inch.
And what kind of pressure is it under? It's just gravity or?
No, it's under pressure, but I want to say it's like 40 PSI or something. Mm-hmm.
So one of the other items worth noting is the $600,000 increase in water line replacement.
Yep.
That line item is normally funded at $400,000. It goes up to $1 million in fiscal year 2015, and the scheduled projects are Hinckley, Pine Street Bridge, Pond Street Roundabout, and Winslow.
Winslow, yep.
The total is about $1,500,000. But we have about $500,000 encumbered, so we're going to fund that at $1 million in 2015.
That was also discussed at the last budget meeting we had.
Do we want to take a look at the Stormwater Enterprise Fund as it stands currently?
Sure.
Stormwater? So we're trying to put together the necessary resources for the new Stormwater and Flood Control Enterprise Fund. And this budget was kind of built from the ground up. So far we have $1,889,238 programmed into the various categories. We anticipate FEMA funding of $120,600. And we don't have any indirects for this enterprise fund yet. So that piece is missing. There's also a question of catch basin cleaning cost.
Yeah, there'd be an operational expense to manage the catch basin cleanings.
I may have missed this when I first came, but was there approval last night?
It was at about 11:40. Just before today.
So for this sort of department request, I don't have any variance items because it's the first year that it's been established.
Mm-hmm.
But you have your detail sheets behind the summary schedules.
It never gets any easier than this, huh?
And there's a the storm drains portion. We have various expense items that have been identified. The operations and maintenance total is $151,450. Under capital line items, we went through the vehicle replacement schedule. The allocated portion, 33% to this storm drain division. Is $100,600.
So on the OM back up at the top, as Amory mentioned, we pretty much built this budget from the bottom up. But we do have records of money that we spent in the past in the storm drain division. So one thing that we did is we went line by line through the proposed MS4 permit, which is an EPA permit related to how we manage the stormwater system. And then we anticipated what some of the expenses would be in order to comply with that permit, although the permit has not been issued yet. So this budget would allow us to comply with a permit that wouldn't be issued, or it may not be issued, but we're not sure. It keeps being delayed. It was supposed to be last fall, and now it's March, and we haven't seen the new draft. But this budget would allow us to comply with the requirements of that permit. And there are some things that we would probably do to move ahead to prepare ourselves, because some of the things that EPA wants us to do would be considered best management practices anyway. So there are things that we would want to do, even though the permit's not out. And there are other things that we might not do because it would be an expense that we might incur that we might not otherwise incur. So there'd be a few, if the permit's not issued by July 1st, probably would be a thought process within the department about how we want to approach the tasks that we need to do. So just so you have a sense of where, how these OM numbers came to be.
I'm curious about the, you know, so you've got a budget for FY 2015, which presumably this, the department starts collecting the revenue on July 1. Right, there is no revenue, right?
Well, it'll start billing July 1.
Of course. So we start getting some income on July 1, and then you have to look at, so I'm just curious about this permit, which sounds like it's unknown at this point, but at what point do you start, you have enough money to do the work,
so
to be in compliance? In other words, what's the timing of the complaint? You have, all right, here's your permit, and you need to comply right now, or you have 1 year? How does that work?
Well, for that permit, there's different dates that you get a certain amount of time to accomplish certain things.
Okay. That's what I assume.
And as you can imagine, if they give you a year to do something, it might take a year to actually do it.
Yes.
Or if they give you 90 days, you know, it might be nice to have 120 days, but they only give you 90, so you do the best you can to meet the deadlines that they've outlined. And the implementation is staged, depending on what they're asking you to do.
Right.
So.
And you've really, as far as I know, by just from my local experience, you've already done some of the work that I guess was in the whatever the letter of non-compliance from the Army Corps or whoever on the dike.
We've done a little bit of
trimming, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, you know, it looks good. I mean, the work that we've done looks great.
Yeah.
It's only a fraction of what we need to do.
Oh, I know.
And it shows, you know, the city's intent to, you know, we're of serious intent, as they like to say in the movies,
yes.
to take care of the levees, and the money that will come in through the new Stormwater and Flood Control Enterprise Fund will allow us to do some of the other things that the Corps is asking us to do. So there's maintenance work, like we're doing in the Mill River levee, similar maintenance work in the Connecticut River levee system that we need to do. And then there's a levee certification process that we need to do to do an engineering evaluation of the levee system designs that were done back in the 30s. So that's sort of a significant engineering task that needs to be undertaken. And then the Hockenham Road pump station evaluation is another big piece that's plugged into the budget for the coming year, where we'd hire an engineering firm to really go through every aspect of the pump station and look at alternatives for renovation or replacement. So we'll have a direction for the pump station for the future. Those are the projects that we've been talking about throughout the city, and those are the ones that are reflected in the numbers that Anne-Marie has in the budget. So I think the message has been pretty consistent. We have really not come up with any surprises or sort of new things as we prepared the budget.
You've talked in the past about nitrogen reduction. Is that part of the MS4? Is that are they one and the same? Or?
Nitrogen just applies to everything, it seems. Nitrogen reduction is something that's required under the wastewater treatment plant discharge permit. So there's some sort of components to that, what we discharge from our treatment plant into the Connecticut. But also the MS4 permit also has some nitrogen reduction discussion in there. So there's a component to that as well. I'd be hard pressed to describe to you what their guidance is gonna be in terms of documenting nitrogen removal in stormwater.
So that's how we just don't know at this point.
We don't know. I think it's going to be, in some sense, I think it might be paper calculations in terms of what you're doing for best management practices for stormwater maintenance and what they're assuming nitrogen reduction might be if you do certain things. So I think it might be that type of calculation for reporting. The regulators require that we do, there's a lot of stuff that's coming out now where they sort of have a proxy for the removal, whether it's gas emissions or stormwater or wastewater. It just seems like a lot of times they set up an accounting model for how you deal with these things, and you have to run your own system specific information into that, and it will sort of spit out a number in terms of whether you're complying with the intent of the permit. I think it's a little bit You know, I mean, those are the rules they set up and the rules that we'd have to follow. But at this point, I couldn't describe exactly how we would meet the nitrogen reduction intention on the stormwater side. And of course, it's all related to the Long Island Sound and eutrophication problems down there, low DO down in the Sound. And those things are, the regulators are working all the way up the river to try to limit the amount of nitrogen that anybody discharges. So it's a little bit of a question. Guidance doesn't really exist in terms of how we would document compliance with it.
How big an item could it be?
I'm assuming that it's going to be things that we've already accounted for in terms of best management practices or green infrastructure.
I mean, we've already paid for it, or we already do it.
Meaning that we already have it built in the budget. Like green infrastructure, for example, dealing with stormwater discharges that run through a constructed wetland or some other type of system or helping removing a certain percentage of nitrogen. So we have that sort of activity already in the budget, and I think that would probably account for some of the nitrogen reduction. In other words, I don't think we're expecting that there's going to be other some other big secret that's going to come out in the final permit that we haven't thought about.
That's kind of what I was questioning.
Like you drop a little pill into each catch basin? Like the tidy bowl thing you put in the tank and it takes up the nitrogen?
We're thinking of roadside swales.
Yeah, that is what I was assuming would have to mean, that you have to capture the water. To hold it, you distill the water, and then the nitrogen then what? Evaporates? Or it goes, what is it? I don't understand the chemical process.
Well, nitrogen would be assimilated, it's a nutrient.
Okay.
So
plant material takes it up. That's right. The idea, that it just needs to stay in time.
And it might be, there's a lot of discussion about sort of low impact development design related to stormwater. And things related to these swales that Nen talks about, or even infiltration of stormwater into the soil.
Yeah.
There are removal mechanisms within the soil, sort of microbiology and things at a much smaller level in the soil that will also result in some nitrogen uptake. So there's a variety of ways that nitrogen can be removed.
Mm-hmm.
It's a lot more controlled process at the wastewater plant, but within stormwater, mainly vegetation and soil and general assimilation. If you can delay how quickly the stormwater gets discharged to the river, the ways in which you delay will result in some uptake of the nitrogen and removal of it.
Right.
But it's harder with wastewater, is what you're saying.
There's a lot more nitrogen in wastewater. So the processes that we do, in the aeration tanks and those types of processes, it's really what nature does,
mm-hmm.
but it's very highly controlled in terms of biosolids and things that we use to remove nitrogen from wastewater.
Mm-hmm.
So there's just a lot more of it.
Last year's PICR engineering program looked at green infrastructure in the city and
mm-hmm.
types of devices that we can install and possible locations where they could be done.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of a primer for what we need going forward with this new permit.
Was that with Drew Guswell?
Yeah.
No.
It wasn't Drew.
It was
professor there.
Yes. Susanna Hupp?
It was with Susanna.
Okay.
It was a good project. The project that we did was predicated on requirements of the MS4 permit. So there's sort of a prioritization that had to be done with city property. So if you read the permit, it says that you need to look at all city property and prioritize it in terms of your ability to retrofit the stormwater systems on those properties with green infrastructure. So the project involved coming up with a master list of all city property, what the property is, what department it has, what it has for stormwater systems, and then sort of prioritize this list of these things. And there was obviously a list of criteria that we used to determine which would land higher or lower. And then the second part of the project was coming up with looked at two or three sites and provided alternatives for constructing green infrastructure to manage stormwater. So it was kind of a good head start on one aspect of the permit, I think.
Mm-hmm.
But it was a good exercise to go through.
Any more discussion on stormwater?
Yeah, I was wondering about on the expense, the budgeted expenses. I heard that the indirects are not included because we don't know what they are. And Jim, I thought you made a comment about some aspect of catch basin cleaning management not included. So it looks to me like it's likely the ultimate budget will be over $2 million.
It won't be.
Well, I know it can't be. That's sort of my point.
Right.
Okay.
So this is a preliminary budget. We threw a lot of things, and it's actually a remarkable building from the ground up. And it reflects our approach to putting the budget together early on, which was sort of a simpler approach to get the budget together. And now going through the details and building it from the ground up. And we've identified a couple of new items that are expenses that are a little bit higher. The catch basin cleans is really, it'll be a number in the tens of thousands of dollars probably. And we're trying to deal with these things in an appropriate manner, coming up with a way to do it. But we realize we can't be over $2 million, and hopefully we won't be. And if we are, then you look at ways to get it under and delay certain activities or whatever. Yeah.
Then, what's the billing frequency if we start billing in July?
Quarterly.
So then a concern I have is it's not likely that we'll see. We certainly won't see all the revenue from the fourth quarter billings, so that in this first year we may not have revenue that matches expenses.
That's a good question, and not a question I'd love to know the answer to. And maybe I don't know if Ann Marie knows. So when you start the new enterprise fund, you start sending the bills out in July. People have a certain amount of time to pay, and then the money gets in. And in the meantime, we're expending money, so it's almost like you need a construction loan or something, right, to cover this. To cover the period of time from when you're incurring expenses, but the revenue that you're relying on is sort of delayed through the billing process. I don't know if we've had any discussions within the city about how you cover that time frame, and there's a gap. I don't know if that's specifically your question. But.
No, I was more. I mean, that's a pretty important question too. But I was more concerned about the fourth quarter bills go out, and I don't know how long people have to pay them. So if they go out on April 1st, will we see most of that revenue in FY15? What do we get, 30 days to pay?
30 days.
So I guess we will. So then my concern isn't as great, that by the time we finish the fiscal year, we should have collected most of the revenue. And I would imagine when we set the rates, there'll be some assumption regarding non-payments. We don't assume that we collect 100% of the bills. Is that correct?
We do in this water and sewer enterprise fund. We take a look at historically how much is not collectible, and we build that into the rate schedule.
So we actually have got decent records, right? If you look at it from that standpoint, the line for the stormwater utility is bill will be on the water and sewer bills for people that are currently customers, and then there'll be a series of new bills. I mean, non-payment, I guess we have a general sense of what percentage of population doesn't pay their bill. And maybe we can apply that in a similar manner.
The homeowner gets a single amount to pay for three categories instead of two.
Right, on one bill. Though.
Same bill.
Right.
Not a big dollar change.
Right.
But only if they're paying for water.
Correct. There will be people who will be getting a bill for the first time. In the city in that regard. If they don't have city water and sewer,
they'll still get a stormwater fee.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so farmland, for instance.
Me, for instance.
Yeah, anybody with a private well or a septic system.
Right. Right.
Huh.
So, do we want to move to the final landfill enterprise?
I don't know if you want to have more detail on the personal services, because I didn't have all of the explanation of the variances. I do have the schedules that were put together to come up with the final numbers for storm drain. If you want to get into that level of detail, I can make copies available to you.
I'm good.
I'd like to see it. Of course, that means I have to read it.
Yay.
So the landfill enterprise, again, this is the 2015 budget. We're not projecting any future because we don't know what's going to happen going forward. DOR certified free cash was at $1.9 million at the end of fiscal year 2013. We still have a closure fund available for closure and post-closure costs in the landfill.
And that's separate from this free cash?
Yes. So for the transfer station, we've done away with any expenses that are associated with the landfill itself. That division of the landfill enterprise fund has been eliminated entirely. It was only funded at $8,750 in the past, so it's not a significant reduction. It's just gone away completely in fiscal year 2015. For the transfer station, the personal services increased by $27,528. We replaced the senior solid waste coordinator position with a solid waste planner position, and we replaced the personal principal clerk position with a solid waste coordinator. We have anticipated an increase for the gatekeeper's expenses, and that's assuming a hourly increase to $12 per hour. There's an anticipated increase in overtime. And then there's the longevity.
Overtime due to?
The Saturday.
Right. That's our SMEO, our special motor equipment operator, moving trash and recyclables around on Saturdays.
Yeah, but it's still cheaper than hiring another person to do it.
Yes. So David Bledo was pretty instrumental in putting together this budget. He took a look at the previous history, given what's been happening in the transfer station this year, and then kind of extrapolated what he expected to happen through the end of fiscal year 2014 and based his 2015 budget on that. So as a result of that, we do have a loss in the transfer station. And I guess the question that needs to be asked is, what level of service do we want to provide here, and can we get that loss down to zero, or are you comfortable with funding the anticipated loss through the fund balance that's available in retained earnings?
So the ways to increase the revenues is through the sticker program or the bag fee program are the ways to immediately increase our revenue. Currently the stickers are $25. Could they go up to $50? Should they go to $60 or $70?
Depends how many customers you want to lose.
I understand that.
Are there any demand curves for anything like this in literature? I know
we're
that that's
so far involved. From being involved in any literature. Our system is so unique that.
But
I'll say anecdotally that if you look at the number of vehicle permits that were sold through the years, the drop, and it's not just last year, but the drop in like the last 4 or 5 years has been pretty dramatic. And you know, I personally would ask the question, could it actually drop any further than it's dropped when you look at the numbers? Because there's always sort of a core group of people that use the facility that just won't go anywhere else.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm actually
mm-hmm.
wondering whether we're sort of getting to that point. And I mentioned in the one of the previous board meetings that I don't feel like it's only the cost that's the issue, but that we may be losing customers on the low side of the income brackets because they can go without a vehicle permit to do so, but also on the high side for the people that are moving into town, buying expensive homes,
mm-hmm.
and can afford to have someone come to their house and pick up their trash. People will do that if they can afford to pay for it, and I suspect that we're losing kind of on both sides of the economic scale,
mm-hmm.
and that there's sort of an area in the middle where we have the sweet spot for the customers that use these facilities, and you know, we might be approaching sort of that rock central part of what the customer base is, and how much further it can erode. You know, if you raise the fees, I don't really know, but you know, as Ned has indicated here, one of the ways to reduce the amount of deficit is to increase the amount of money that you raise through the fee.
What is DUSO charge per bag, or how does that work? I've never been there.
I haven't either. I use this facility. I find it remarkably clean and friendly.
Convenient.
Force of habit. I don't know. It's really close.
On your way to work?
Yeah.
So just for in a blunt, how would you feel if you didn't have this facility to use?
I would feel that the city shirked its responsibility to provide solid waste management services for the residents of Northampton. That's how I would feel personally. But you could ask me with my city engineer's hat on some other time, maybe.
So Dave would have made some assumptions here, assuming that we retain the same amount of stickers that are being sold currently. And if we went to $50 a sticker, that would raise another $82,500 in revenue. It went to 30, well, let me start on the low side. We went to $30, it would be $16,500. We went to 40, it would be $49,500. We went to $50 for the sticker, it would be $82,500.
Couldn't write very fast. If we increased to 30,000.
Can we just have this available for
yeah.
the.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That would be lovely. Thank
you. But the deficit is 120,000.
Yeah, we're not even getting close.
That's a lot.
I mean, strategically, I think it would make sense to raise the fee personally, even if it's by a little bit. Because you'll find if you're going to see further erosion, you'll test the market to see how sensitive it is to adjustments in the vehicle permit.
And if we know that there's a commitment, I don't know about the board, but just a general commitment to at least continue it for one more year, we would have that experimental time.
Right. You could take a couple of years if you wanted to.
Okay.
So if DUSO is, they're not charging, you don't have to have a permit. Anyone can go there. And you're disposing of your waste by bag? Is that how they do it? Or
by bag or can, you know, yeah. I think they just...
And they're charging roughly what we're charging to receive the charge?
I think so.
Yeah, approximately.
That's what we thought last year.
Okay. Interesting. Under how they're...
But there's some services that they don't provide, such as composting, yard waste, things of that nature that we do with our sticker program.
Right.
You can bring a refrigerator there, probably for the same cost that you can bring a refrigerator to us.
Yeah. Then there's certain items like refrigerators, tires probably, mm-hmm. other things, mattresses, you just pay a fee for the
flat
item.
Fee. Yeah.
Do you know if they publish if we went down there, I guess I should go down there.
Yeah, it's available. Sure.
I think Dev has the rates right here.
At their facility?
Yeah.
Well, we should look at what they've got and what we've got there.
We have.
Yeah.
And he's saying they're comparable.
They're pretty comparable.
Yeah. So maybe it really is location, right? It's maybe based on where population is, you might have more people using this facility because they're closer, possibly.
Convenience factor.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't travel into East Hampton. It's out of the way.
Yeah.
This is convenient.
Right.
Are we still, remember how in the early days, well, early for me, there was a talk about the congestion on Saturdays here at the transfer station? Have we noticed any diminishment of that?
Yeah, we fixed that problem.
Yeah, David says if we get rid of all our customers, we have no traffic.
Who would have guessed that?
We haven't noticed a big... problem with the change. Yeah.
We still have a police officer typically out here on Saturdays because of the heavy traffic. If that wasn't an issue, we wouldn't be paying that $140 for a half day detail here every Saturday.
There's a savings.
Yeah, move a little closer to $100,000 in debt.
There's a $6,000 budget line item for those details.
Say that again?
$6,000 is the budget item for police details here on Saturdays.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's interesting how a lot of people view this as something that needs to be in the black, but, you know, it's really a service to the citizens and their public health implications associated with providing this service or not providing it, and the level that you do provide it, you don't provide it. Many, many communities rely on the general fund to provide these services as a benefit to living in a, a community. So tying it to being in the black, I think is, you know, it's an interesting way to view this type of service, because we're probably one of the, I would say that we might be one of the few towns possibly that could be looking at it this way of our size. There was an article in the Gazette the other day about the town of Granby. They just went out to bid for curbside collection across their community, and they're, I think they're looking at an override to pay for curbside collection for their town. I mean, it's amazing to me. So Granby, they've got a landfill. They had, I think they were probably getting some collection through waste management, and now that landfill is going to be closed up and they're moving on, and like that, they're out to bid. They've got a price for curbside collection. They're talking about an override to provide this sanitation service to the residents of the community. And as far as, you know, we'll see how the vote goes, but, you know, very in a very short amount of time, there's another community, unlike us, we've already had the task force, which went on for months and months and months, and we came up with a solution with what we have now, and now the mayor's talking about another task force, and it might be a fee-based system. I mean, there's just so many things. Sometimes it seems like we work really hard to make things really hard in other communities, and I consulted with a lot of communities when I was in the private sector that were in the exact same situation that this town is in, and many other communities are just like, okay, there's a change here. We need to acknowledge that our landfill is closing and we need to have a curbside collection program. They figure out what the cost is, and then they ask the residents to pay for it, because it's sort of the sanitation. You don't want trash in the streets and, you know, everything, all the other associated problems with it. So you look at providing the service and you ask the residents to pay for it, and then it gets implemented. So here there's just so much, you know, we pinch over every dollar. And I appreciate that as well. You know, we want to be prudent with the money, but sometimes the overall approach to how we deal with solid waste management in the city, you know, sometimes maybe we should just take a look way up here and then see what we're trying to do and accomplish, and then see if it makes sense, rather than down here where, hey, we could raise that bag fee by 25 cents and next year we could make $2,000 more and see how that happens. Because it's, you know, it's hard. It's in some ways it's the wrong way to view things. So if you look at all the great work that the reuse committee is doing and these events that we have to get different types of materials out of the solid waste stream, and they're open to everybody in the community, and waste diversion, and these are all great things, but, you know, everything comes with a price. Many people are benefiting from these diversion programs right now, and they don't pay anything for them. And I guess you could ask, should they? Mm-hmm. Or should it be a general fund type of service that's provided by the community? But right now, we're incurring expenses like these reuse events, and they may not be that expensive, but the fact is that those are being paid for by a small subset of residents that choose to buy these vehicle permits. So there's a lot of interconnectedness in what we do, but a lot of shortfalls in the way we look at how we fund providing the services.
I really appreciate what you're saying, because you're talking about this as a at one level, this is a philosophical decision about what, how we want to spend our energy and our money, and on whose backs do we want to spend it.
Right.
The other thing is, I will say that when we did the solid waste task force that Higgins started, Mayor Higgins started, there was a commitment to do another task force to seek to evaluate this. So those that philosophy could be examined based on on that.
Yeah, I mean, I'd be happy to do it on the task force, sort of, maybe not.
It was many, different from
the analysis, like the numbers will change. We did a ton of spreadsheets for that, mm-hmm. as you recall. And lots of analysis, and it was 2 or 3 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
But the basic assumptions, those numbers will change a little bit, but the basic assumptions and results of the decision making will be the same.
Mm-hmm.
You might just have a different group of people. That was mm-hmm. a great group of people. A lot of people put in a lot of time and effort into that,
mm-hmm.
which was great to see. But it's really this, you know, sort of the policy level discussion that needs to happen. And some people, I think Donna Sloan from the Board of Health really approached it from that standpoint.
Mm-hmm.
She was looking at a little bit more about how do we keep the community safe in terms of dealing with mm-hmm. solid waste and trash. I mean, mm-hmm. that's, and I think that's historically would be a very sound view, mm-hmm. a way to view this type of problem.
I guess that's why I'm wondering if a subcommittee of the BPW would make more sense in the beginning, just to sort of outline the different issues that are involved. And I'm wondering, I'm not proposing at this point, but it's something for us all to think about. It's a radical change to think about doing away with the transfer station, but it's a radical change thinking that ultimately, while we have money in the solid waste fund, we won't always have money in the solid waste enterprise fund. So then we have to say, where will that money come from? So even though right now it's not an issue, are there other directions? And I think that's where we really miss the senior solid waste coordinator position, because we can all spend hours on the internet trying to research this and reading the story of stuff and reading all the other issues, but it's not going to help us figure out what our community needs to do.
Well, I think a lot of the task force work that was done by David Valletta and myself.
Totally.
So whether that position,
so we still have you.
I mean, whether we have a full-time solid waste planner or not, I mean, we have the knowledge and skill to figure out what the options are.
Mm-hmm.
And the most difficult question associated with implementing curbside collection for this city is that we have a system. If you implement curbside collection and you ask people to pay a fee, the problem that we recognized was that the people on the low end of the income scale are going to be asked to pay more. The people that have curbside collection now are going to pay less for the same service that they're getting.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a very difficult argument for anybody to make that you want to provide curbside collection for the whole community, yet the impact in the current system that we have is the people on the low end of the scale are being asked to pay more, and the people that can afford to have curbside collection now will pay less under a citywide contract.
So you're saying there's no difference, really? If we raise sticker fees, then lower income people might be paying more, but if we have a citywide curb collection, same outcome.
Probably not exactly, but the concept is there. And the mayor had said to me at one point, well, if we keep raising the sticker fees, aren't we at some point going to be at the same price of asking people to pay for curbside collection? And I don't think we're there yet, but it is that concept of you raising the fee. But you can see why it would be a hard argument. If it's fee-based, if it's general fund-based, and you talk about a collection contract is $400,000 or whatever it is, and we're trying to get that money in the general fund, then you don't have those specific fee-based questions where someone that's paying $25 for a vehicle permit now is all of a sudden asked to pay $200 for curbside collection. Someone that's paying $400 for curbside collection now is being asked to pay $200. You don't get down to that level of analysis. It's more like a service that's provided for the community good. It's included in the general fund, whether the money exists in the general fund or whether you need an override like some communities have done. I mean, these are really the hard questions, and a lot of them are, they're policy-based. I mean, you can look at all the numbers, but we just, in about 10 minutes, described the factors that impact that decision.
And the unexpected consequences, like will you reduce the amount of, will you increase the amount of recycling because of having to pay some of these fees?
There are some other conversations that probably will start this calendar year, the next fiscal year, with the board about properties that the solid waste division or the enterprise fund owns. There's building lots, there's potential for development, there's potential for solar at the landfill in the future.
That's exactly what I was thinking.
Yeah.
And what the, if you look at the income of the total revenue, cell tower drives that thinking for me is what else can we do with that property? And I know that we have a parcel that we could sell off as building lots or put a large PV array, and I think, I don't know what kind of income you would actually generate from a large PV array, but that would be $120,000 a year. But it does make me think about what do people do with closed landfills aside from large solar arrays.
My understanding also that the SRECs are going to increase the value of them for building solar arrays on brownfields, and the landfill could be in that same category.
I would think so, yeah. I think that is where the income comes from, is the SREC. It's not the sale of the electricity, it's solar renewable energy credits. So it's.
And I'm trying to remember what Smith Volk was bringing in next door in a quarter. I think it was, think it was like $15,000 every quarter they were getting on their tracks.
Yeah, that's a small array. I'm curious about also the trash bag sales. It seems, I'm sort of surprised at the jump in number from 13 to 14. It goes up to almost 100,000, and then it drops 160,000 from 14 to 15. And I'm not sure, how did you calculate that? I mean, what happened between 13 and 14? That surprises me. And then how did you calculate the difference between last year and the upcoming year? Trash bag sales? I'm just curious. Because if we sold the same amount of trash bags.
Well, 14 is a budget number, really not the actual.
Okay.
So that's probably started it.
David based his numbers again on the experience that we're seeing in 2014, and then he projected what would be the end outcome for the full fiscal year.
Yeah, I apologize. I don't have the numbers in front of me to tell you how exactly we determine this. But there's been some fluctuation in the bag sales because when we had sort of a rush in the market, right? When we advertised the fact that we were going to increase the price for the bags,
yeah.
You know, you see people walking out of Cooper's with, okay. you know, a year's worth of bags.
Right.
So
like forever stamps.
Yeah, exactly. So there's been some fluctuations in bag sales because of that, and that's actually one good reason for getting another full year of operation under our belt is some of these things that have just been sort of fluctuating.
Yeah.
We implemented the bag system, then we changed the bag, then we raised the fee. There's sort of a lot of things that haven't been static, so it's a little bit hard to take the temperature overall in the system, and another year would help us with that.
Well, it's when you compare it to the stickers, where there's sort of this decline, and then there's this increase in bags, and then a sharp decline. And I had forgotten that makes perfect sense that we were about to change. We did raise the price, and so that was a sale.
Yeah.
But maybe
we raised the price on bags.
Yeah, we went from $3.
Doubled everything.
$2 to $4 for the big bag.
Two to three. While we're talking about revenue. There's an entry for compost membership. Is that a proposal to establish a fee to deliver compost? Is that what's behind that?
Do you think that might be the pedal people?
Yes.
Okay.
Pedal people.
Right.
So the pedal people use our facility here to drop off food waste, and we charge them a fee for them to use this facility.
And sludge disposal as a revenue attached to it? $10,000. I don't understand what that would be from.
Maybe we should ask David to come to the next meeting.
Well, I'm happy to do it. If I was prepared, I could do it without David, but I'm simply not prepared.
Well,
I have all the information, and I've worked with David on developing the budgets as well.
Could we revisit this at the next meeting?
We could, sure. I mean, we had a pretty long discussion at when we gave the update to the budget.
Yes, I know.
Yeah. But we can, happy to do that again.
Some of us weren't here for that.
Oh, were some of us gone?
Goofy, no.
So, sorry.
You have an answer?
Yeah,
well,
I'd love to hear it.
Unfortunately, it was an error. That should be under other miscellaneous, not under sludge disposal, so it's improperly.
So 10,000 is just in the wrong line item?
That's right.
I was hoping it was a little side business where we could make some money.
If you could make money off of sludge, all our problems would be gone. And then,
thank you.
The last comment I have is I see there's no cost for landfill maintenance under landfill enterprise, but I'm wondering about maintenance of the landfill and mowing and whether we have ongoing obligations to maintain the site. So,
do you want me to spend part of that $1.9 million on the site for 30 years?
Well, if that's the answer, then that's fine. But I didn't know where those costs were coming from.
So we do have, in the landfill portion of the enterprise fund budget, there is a line item for closure costs.
Yeah.
We've been expending out of that line item and encumbering each year. So those closure costs are ongoing. We've been spending out of that line item for 2014. In 2015, I think we're anticipated to probably cover about $500,000 in that line item for ongoing costs. So we'll be spending that down, encumbering and spending as each year passes. And then at some point in the future, we'll have to make a transfer out of the closure fund to reestablish money available for the ongoing annual closure costs. But it'll be under a closure line item in the landfill.
Okay. And that's where the money comes to monitor groundwater quality?
Yep.
And may I ask another, are you done?
I guess I am, because whatever was there just...
Okay. So, but we're required to keep a certain percentage balance for 30 years?
We are. So the it's actually, it's kind of interesting that the financial assurance mechanism that we talk about ad nauseum is, the terms of what goes into that FAM are dictated by DEP.
Mm-hmm.
So there's sort of a, you know, they have sort of their minimum obligation, the types of things that you need to do when you fix a price to that, and they review that and approve it, and we update it routinely. But there are some other, there's some other expenses that the city will incur 10, 20, 30 years down the road that actually aren't captured in that FAM. So the undesignated fund balance, and the fact that we have money in there, and Ned mentioned this a minute ago, what we're trying to do with, and we'll be doing in the next few months, is identifying estimates for things that we know will need to be done that haven't been budgeted yet. And you know, Ned had mentioned the decommissioning of the flare, for example. Eventually, gas generation at the landfill is going to reach the point where we're not going to need to operate that flare anymore. We're going to have a large piece of equipment connected to a lot of piping and gas extraction wells and things, and we need to do something with that, and that costs money. So we need to decommission and remove the equipment. We need to remove the well heads from the gas extraction wells and put some other type of top on those. There are some other things, a leachate pump station, some other things. So what we're trying to do in the next few months is to look out what are the range of possible things that the city will need in the next 30 years before the landfill is like totally static, and then make sure that we have the money from the undesignated fund balance or free cash or whatever you want to call it into the FAM, so that there's the money that the city needs in the long run is going to be there. So it's really trying to anticipate everything that's going to be needed. And when the state asks you to develop the FAM, you know, they don't go to that level.
Mm-hmm.
And but it would be prudent planning really to do that, to make sure we have enough money set aside.
And just where do we stand on our old debt? Is that paid off, or is that come out of the FAM?
We have a capital transfer in fiscal year 2014, that 564,838. That's
yep.
To pay off all of the outstanding debt. Susan Wright is now looking into paying that off early, and then possibly reducing that amount we might experience as a result of an early pay down of that debt.
Right, there's an estimated savings that I think about $16,000 or $17,000 by paying that off 4 years early, 3 years early.
How much?
I think it was $16,000 or $17,000 was the estimate.
We talked about recently deferring ordering new bags until we figured out where we're going. How's our bag supply look now?
I don't have that information at the tip of my tongue.
So we're not running out of bags.
We're not.
You could find probably dozens of them in every household in Northampton.
Well, but I was thinking of our inventory.
Hundreds of few.
Yeah. Not wanting to buy a gigantic inventory if we're going to diminish rapidly.
Sounds to me like there's interest in operating one more year even at a deficit.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I have one more. Is it AmeriGas that we now sell our
Ameresco?
Ameresco, thank
yeah.
you. So, are we having diminishing returns on the gas that's been, or will we have, if we don't know yet, will we have diminishing returns on the generated
sure.
methane?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
And so, do we have a contract with them for a certain number of years?
We do.
And then they would have to. How many years is that?
I believe it's a 20-year contract.
Oh,
two tags.
Okay.
It doesn't amount to much.
Royalties currently, I think we're about $8,000 to $10,000 a year, all depending on gas production.
Is it tied to electric rates at all? Supposedly our electric rates are going up, and we don't really pay much attention to that. Mm-hmm.
It's not. The royalty payment is described in the document.
So under this line, is it under other miscellaneous?
Mm-hmm. It is.
Kind of wish we had another stack to go
through. Think of a second.
There's at least more paper.
Is
it time to go?
Will we adjourn?
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Excellent.